I wasn't motivated with school. I didn't really care to graduate. I wasn't quite sure what I was doing, you know, after high school. I was all over the place. I was definitely a mess before JAG. And I think that's why when I heard about it, I kind of jumped to it.
A lot of times in high school, kids don't see the connection between what they're doing in class and what they're going to be doing when they get out of school. And so I think getting them out and giving them these experiences gives them the opportunity to see, you know, the stuff does matter and I do need to know this, or, you know, maybe I should take this class next year, and really kind of helps them plan for their future better than I think they normally do.
Many of our families who work, who are just involved in a variety of things within their own careers, don't always have the time to ensure that all of the pieces that need to be in place for their child to be successful in high school are in place. So that's where JAG comes right on along. They partner with our families, they help students write resumes, they give interviews, job placement, internships. So really, no matter whether you are a low socioeconomic family or an upper income family, we have found that our parents overwhelmingly support JAG and really depend on JAG to be a partner to help their child take the next step.
We all come from different backgrounds, but when we are in the classroom, we all connect like family, and we all really are like family. And it's just a really nice environment to be in.
They start to believe in themselves. That's the biggest issue. We have kids who, for whatever reason, feel they can't do this, that, or, you know, the other, just because no one has ever said they could do it.
They really instill a lot of hope in you, like the hope that you don't have in yourself.
I believe JAG-K has a unique way of getting people out of their comfort zone, but still respecting their boundaries, and that's what we've done.
High school is a lot of times we're really trying to prepare kids for university. And we do have a lot of kids who go to college. We have a lot of kids who go to university and they do well. We have kids who do well in trade schools and vo-tech and that sort of thing, and those are good too. You don't have to go, you know, and that's weird coming from somebody who went to college and got a degree and all that, but that's not what everybody needs. There are lots of jobs that need training but don't need a degree necessarily.
So when we found that JAG existed and that it's supported, and it didn't need to be fully supported by our district, but it is supported on a state level, it doesn't get any better than that.
I would encourage any district considering JAG to get started. Don't wait. Kids are depending on it.
Good morning, and welcome to the very first JAG-K Employer Summit. I'm Kim Fertig, Director of Employer Engagement. And before we begin this morning, I want to remind everyone to please mute yourself. We do have someone monitoring the chat box, so if you have questions during the presentations, you can put those there. Natalie, would you say hello? Natalie is our amazing Director of Training. Is she on yet? I'm sure she will be on. She's going to help monitor the chat, and I'll watch it until then. So, all right. I guess she's not here yet. So, okay. What we'll get to as many questions as possible after the presentation. So just put those there in the chat box. So this morning, we're going to take the opportunity to share with you about what makes JAG-K unique and extremely effective. What is the JAG advantage? Who are the students we serve? And what do they gain from JAG-K? And how do we connect these well-prepared students to Kansas employers? We'll also hear about a successful partnership between John Deere and Iowa JAG and learn how we can replicate that formula for success with businesses like yours. But first, allow me to introduce to you the president of Jobs for America's Graduates, Kansas, Chuck Knapp. Chuck grew up on a small farm southeast of Augusta, Kansas, graduated from KU in 1988, and has spent most of his life in public service, including jobs in both the private and public sectors. He became JAG-K's second president and CEO on August 1st, 2016, and for that, we are all very grateful. If you haven't met Chuck, he's someone you definitely want to get to know. Let's give a warm, silent Zoom welcome to Chuck Knapp.
Thank you. Thanks, Kim. Pardon me. And thank you, everyone, for joining us for our first JAG-K Employer Summit. Obviously, we couldn't do this without employers, so we appreciate all of you and taking some time out of your day to join us and learn a little bit more about JAG-K, and then later with the roundtable, we'll have a discussion with more of our team. I do want to thank Kim, Natalie, and the rest of our JAG-K team for getting this all together, especially given the circumstance of COVID-19. Obviously, we'd love to be in person, but in some ways, doing it virtual allows us to get more people involved so they don't have to travel. So it's worked out. We're really excited about the day. I also want to thank a couple of our JAG-K Board of Directors that I saw on the call. There may be more, but I did see Dennis Mullen and Jamie Stafford, who are participating this morning. We appreciate them for participating this morning, but also for their leadership on the JAG-K Board of Directors. And it's also my honor and privilege to introduce two of the co-hosts for this morning's activity. Alan Cobb is the chairman of our Strategic Advancement Committee. He's also, his regular job, president and CEO of the Kansas Chamber. He started that position in 2017. Prior to that, he has a history of public service, most notably during Senator Bob Dole's presidential campaign in 1996. Alan was the deputy state director for Senator Dole. His areas of expertise at that time in Senator Dole's office included healthcare, insurance, and business and tax legislation. He is a proud Wichita State Shocker, a native of Wichita. He then went to the University of Pennsylvania, where he earned a master's in governmental affairs, and then he returned to his home state of Kansas, where he earned his law degree from Washburn Law School. We're very pleased that he's part of the organization and participating in today's event. And now I'd like to introduce another board member, Delia Garcia, who was most recently the cabinet secretary for the Kansas Department of Labor, but she also has a long history of service prior to that, including her membership as a member of the JAG-K Board of Directors. She made history, Kansas history, in 2004 when she was elected the first Latina and the youngest female to serve in the Kansas legislature. When she was in the Kansas House, she served 6 years, and she served on the Commerce and Labor Committee, and that was at her request. So she's very familiar with small business issues because she was raised in a small business in her native Wichita. Her family owns the oldest family-owned Mexican restaurant in Kansas. It was established in 1963, and she literally grew up in that business with her four sisters in that restaurant. She's received numerous recognitions for leadership and community service, but I will tell you where I have seen her just excel is when she is with our JAG-K students. She has a tremendous connection with them. She spoke to them at our leadership development conference last year, and they just loved her. And she has a very compelling personal story, which helped make that connection. Today, it is my honor to introduce her to tell you a little bit more about JAG-K. Secretary Garcia.
Thank you, Chuck. And good morning, and muy buenos dias, JAG-K. I loved, while we were waiting for everybody to get the morning music that was getting us going. I always like to have music in the back of my head when I start every day. But I do want to say a special thank you to, of course, Kim and Natalie for pulling this off. But Chuck, especially, I've known Chuck for the past few years, even before I was a secretary, when I was a state legislator, and before that, and really have loved being engaging and continued engaging with JAG-K. And a special thanks also to all the districts, the school districts in Kansas who do participate. And as we are doing our first employer summit, thank you, a special thank you to the employers participating. I'd be remiss if I also didn't thank the career specialists who make things happen. I've had the honor, as Chuck said, with meeting some of the specialists and the students last year, a couple times, actually more than that. But the career specialists who are in run about 78 programs in Kansas's middle schools and high schools, serving about, in just last year alone, or this year, I should say, in 2019, 2020, about 4,200 students in the last year. And I think the beauty, and one of the things I love about JAG-K is it's coupled with care and compassion, with follow-up with the students. It's a program that you go through, and then yes, yeah, went by. You also get follow-up even after you finish high school with the program. So students, please take advantage of that. You know, I'd like to say a few seconds to the students. Take advantage of all of what JAG-K resources are. You know, I loved seeing the video before where one of the students says JAG-K is like family. And that's one of the unique things I do love about JAG-K, especially when considering which boards and commissions, you know, for myself to participate on. I really, you know, value and appreciate the family, the familia kind of environment that JAG-K provides. Because for me, you know, as a Latina, I do appreciate that because family is such an important component. And a lot of those things translate with JAG-K. And I do know that another plug I'd like to tell the students is take advantage of the resources like internships. Don't you dare finish high school or college without doing some kind of internship. And we have plenty of employers here who we will probably be willing to offer, with even if it just be a shadow day. And when you are in a position to be able to create or offer internships, you do the same in giving back and perhaps partnering with JAG-K. You students are part of the state's premier career readiness program. And the importance of JAG-K that I'd like to again highlight, and why I support JAG-K and proud to serve on this board, is that it creates a space for amazing young leaders and development, current and present leaders, but also just enhancing what leaders we already have. And really more exciting is the workforce that we, you know, remain, keep here in our beautiful home state of Kansas. I see myself and many of the students, and again, another reason why I value JAG-K and what we stand for, because, you know, JAG-K serves a number of groups of students, like I can relate to myself. You know, 55% minority students, a lot of young women, 81% Latinos, and I myself as a Latino, I think, you know, that is important, again, seeing myself in leadership and in the audience. But get this, this is one, you know, I was able to participate. You know, JAG has been existing in the country for over 40 years. This year is the 40th anniversary. And one of the powerful statistics that I loved how they shared was, for young women, 260% of women in JAG-K get jobs immediately after. And you know, that is gentlemen as well. But I think that's a powerful fact to share, that 260% of women participating in this program will in fact get a job after this. And so again, seeing myself and being able to relate programs and work, the hard work and resources that JAG-K does support, that is a proud reason why I love supporting and will continue engaging with JAG-K and all the great things it does. So without further ado, I will pass this on to the next speaker, and want to say I wish you the best of experiences. Listen to everything, write notes, and students, take advantage of all resources. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Garcia. For 40 years, Jobs for America's graduates has worked across the nation to help young people build professional skills, earn credentials, gain employment, and enter post-secondary education. Through classroom learning, coaching, leadership development, job placement, and other services, youth and young adult students are set on pathways to academic and economic success. The JAG Advantage is an approach created by JAG National to provide student-centered services that help young people achieve their fullest potential, gaining an advantage in today's emerging workforce. The framework consists of three components. First is trauma-informed care, which emphasizes practices that help JAG-K instructors address students' stress and trauma and remove barriers they face. Second is project-based learning, in which students build communication, collaboration, and critical thinking skills through long-term projects that often include local employers. And the third is employer engagement, in which employers provide students with opportunities to learn and grow by providing them with real-life learning experiences and opportunities to explore career opportunities. Members of our JAG-K team will now take a few minutes to further explain each of these vital circles and how they help prepare our students, to be the best future employees for your companies. First, to talk about trauma-informed care, allow me to introduce Christy Prey. Christy is beginning her fourth year as the career specialist at Augusta High School and has done an excellent job working with students there. Christy?
Good morning. As Kim said, I'm beginning my fourth year at Augusta High School, and I just love what we get to do with students and being able to tie in this trauma-informed care. Okay. Trauma-informed care, so I'm going to talk briefly about what it is, how we support students with these barriers in JAG-K, and how employers, hopefully you can understand the benefit to that, that we are helping our kids, even our students, even though they have barriers, we are giving them tools to success. Trauma-informed care is defined as practices that promote a culture of safety, empowerment, and healing. I like to look at it as specialists, we are turning those walls into doors. So I really challenge my students to, yes, we've all been through things. What can we do to stand upon those barriers and to keep going? So we talk about that. We bring in different guest speakers that have also been quite successful, even though having a background that had barriers. So what it might look like in a specialist classroom, we have competencies that we encourage our students to master, and we are very intentional on how we address those for our students to make them successful when they go into their career field. So whether it's going to competitions, we talk about how to be professional, from eye contact to body language to what to wear. We, like I said, have guest speakers come in. We practice with mock interviews so that they're prepared for that day when they get that. They get that interview. We work on resume writing. We're constantly tweaking and improving those. We start to dream. Sometimes our students, they're so focused on tomorrow that then maybe they're not dreaming about where they see themselves in the future. So we research those companies that we would like to be a part of someday. We do go to competitions to promote that leadership. Field trips, conflict resolution. In our lives, we will have conflict, but how can we positively approach that? And then connecting. How do we stay connected and how do we build those connections going forward? So I like this quote real quick. Courage is what it takes to stand up and speak. Courage is also what it takes to sit down and listen. So sometimes we really talk to our students about what exactly is it that we are being told, that we need to really to listen about the advice being given. So I encourage for business owners to come in and share. We take away those barriers by taking tours to those colleges or maybe to those businesses. I'm in a smaller community, and even going into Wichita can maybe be a little intimidating. So as specialists, we remove some of those intimidations or barriers by taking those road trips. We research maybe the top reasons why people are let go from jobs, and we practice those through scenarios in different situations. And again, we do look at conflict and how we can better understand what the other person is saying, and that comes back to the listening. What is the intention behind what we are being told? And these are a couple of my students that just graduated. I had them for 3 years and couldn't be more proud. So again, our JAG-K students are learning leadership. They're overcoming those barriers and standing upon those. They're understanding what the employers of tomorrow are looking for in a good employee. And they're also realizing the power of giving back. One of the cool things about JAG-K is we really promote getting out and doing that community service, so our students have those opportunities to feel proud and giving back to their community.
I'll jump in. My name is Ali Macias, and I work at Emporia High School with the 11th and 12th grade program, and I've been with JAG since 2014, so I'll actually be going on my 7th year at Emporia High School. And so for today, I'm going to talk with you a little bit about project-based learning. So project-based learning is a teaching method that we use within our JAG-K classroom, and it really gives our students the opportunity to have a voice in what they're learning and how they're going to learn. And so it's very hands-on, and it encompasses all of the three JAG advantages. So when we're creating lessons, they're going to incorporate trauma-informed learning. They're going to expose themselves to employer engagement and getting connected in the community. And another great aspect of the JAG-K program is that they do a minimum of 10 hours of community service each school year. So ideally, by the end of graduating, they'll have 40 hours. And again, that's minimal. A lot of our students are doing much more than that. And so we encompass that in our project-based learning approach. And so looking at a PBL, and the Gold Star Standard says that students are going to have a voice and choice in the lessons that we're doing. So they're choosing. Today, I'd really like to focus on this. And so it could be a one-week project. It could be a project that runs the entire semester or even the length of the school year. So again, the students have a voice in that. And then they're going to identify a challenge or a problem that they would ideally like to answer by the end of this PBL project. And then lastly, the goal is for them to have a public product by the end. And so as we go to the next slide, and throughout, I'll kind of share some examples of what our students have done within my program and some other programs as well for PBL. But looking at why is PBL or project-based learning effective within our classroom, we have found that a lot of our students are in classes all day long. They're taking these core classes where a lot of it is lecture based, and by the time they get to you, they're tired, they're burnt out of the day. And so JAG-K has kind of been that place for our students to relax and to come excited for what they're going to learn. And part of that is just because they're having a deeper level of learning. They're having a say in what we're doing. We're exposing them to soft skills. They're collaborating with their classmates. They're collaborating with other members in our school, in our community, employers. They're personal stakeholders in their project ideas. They're coming up with these projects. They're having a say. So they feel like they're in control. And so I think that relates back to that trauma-informed piece as well. If they have a say in what they're learning, they're just going to be a lot more invested. So we're seeing an increase in student engagement. We are also exposing them to different careers and connections. We have found that our students are going to be much more successful within the workforce if they're being exposed early on. They're identifying a career path and what they have interest in, and then they're also building those connections. So through employer engagement, that's a key component as well. And then there's also real world relevance in what they're learning, which allows them to retain that knowledge and problem solve much more. And so on this next slide, these are just a few of Emporia High School students that through a PBL project, they were elected as leaders at the high school level, but then they also went on to compete at the state level. And then they were elected as representatives for JAG at the state level as well. And then on the next photo, this is also another career specialist, Patrick Dake, who also helped me on this presentation, but these are some of his students in that similar position. So they had a chance to go to the Capitol and just represent JAG-K, which was also part of a PBL project. On this next slide, here's some examples of a PBL or a few PBLs that I've done within my classroom. So we know that food shortage is an issue within our community. And so we do have a Spartan stop within our school, and that provides our students a bag weekly where they have food that they can take home, hygiene items. And so that's definitely a high need. So our students knew that, and they wanted to partner with our homeless liaison through this program. So JAG-K at Emporia High School has taken on this project. They went trick-or-treating for food items door by door. So they're using public speaking skills and that connection. And then they were able to take these items back and put them into our Spartan stop. Additionally, another PBL project our students saw a need for was connecting with all students within the school. So we partnered with our special education program, and then the students themselves created this public product, which was a lesson that they went and did with those students. And they did a little watermelon activity and we ate watermelon. So we helped the students cut it and they got to put little seasonings on it. And we just helped them decorate these leaves. And then we did a bulletin board within our school. So this is from the beginning, the students wanted a connection with the special education program to reduce some of those stigmas. And then the public product was partnering with them to do that. And then on this last slide here, this is an example of a student that was from Liberal High School. And so JAG-K has a competition through a leadership conference where students can compete with these project-based learning projects that they design. And so Maria is actually a student I had the opportunity to meet, not only through JAG-K, but my school traveled to Liberal to kind of see how their school functions under a redesign. And so she was one of the students who showed us around the school, and she's just so passionate. And she was so excited to share her project from the beginning was, their school is large. It's a very large school. It's very divided. And so she knew there was a need to include more time for them to eat in the lunchroom and spend with their classmates without having to rush. And so her project was designed on how can she do that? What was the need? How much more time would be successful for them to eat lunch, get to class, and be ready to go. And so from the design product, the beginning was, what was this? How can we fix it? What steps do we need to take? And ultimately, her school agreed with her. They loved the project, and they did extend the school lunchtime. And so Maria had a chance to compete with this PBL project at the national level in representing the JAG-K program, and she placed third overall in the state. At the national level. So that's just an example of how our students are getting engaged and true change is happening. And then I think, again, that ties back to who they built relationships along the way, as far as employers, the community, that connection, and then also that trauma-informed piece of building their confidence and allowing them to see that they do have a voice. So PBL has been really successful within our program. And also we're starting to see a lot of schools in general switch to PBL projects. So thank you for listening. Oh, I take that back. I just wanted to share a last few photos of that employer piece. So we have quite a bit of guest speakers within our school pictured here, community service projects. So these are just some examples that Patrick and I were able to provide, but all of our specialists are doing this because JAG does function under this PBL model. So thank you for your time.
Great job, Allie. Finally, we're going to talk about the final circle of the JAG Advantage that affects you as an employer directly. To share about employer engagement, I'm happy to introduce Joni Bolin. Joni has been with JAG-K for 6.5 years and 4.5 years as a specialist in Hutchinson, and then 2 of those as a regional director. Joni?
Good morning. So I'm here to talk about employer engagement. Employer engagement has 3 main objectives. First one is that employers will interact with JAG-K students in the classroom and on the job. Students will learn real-world competencies that employers want them to have when they come into the job and workforce, and companies will develop a positive culture with the students that makes them want to be a part of that company and makes them want to work there. So what does employer engagement look like? Well, it looks exactly like it sounds. As you can see in the photos, employer engagement is a great opportunity and a unique opportunity for employers to show our amazing JAG-K students job-specific skills and in-depth looks into specific careers. The young ladies in the picture on the right, they're actually in an operating room in Hutchinson Regional Medical Center, learning the protocols to prep somebody for surgery. And just by this experience, the young lady on the right, she's actually pursuing a career in the medical field. She's working as a CNA and has been doing so for the past 3 years. So this experience for her was in middle school, but she used it to her advantage. She fell in love with it, and it led to her obtaining a career in this career field. and the gentleman on the right is showing my students how to change a tire, how to work in a mechanic shop, how to detail cars. So just great experiences for the students to employer engagement. So JAG uses an employer engagement framework to drive the vision and mission of employer engagement. This tiered approach focuses on three things with the main goal in mind. The first tier is career exploration. Students explore the many different career and job options available. Employers will visit classrooms, as you have seen from the last few slides. Many guest speakers come into JAG-K classrooms to expose students to many career opportunities and jobs that are available within their communities and also within within the United States. We've had many guest speakers visit our classrooms virtually, especially during the pandemic. We've still pushed forward with employer engagement. Guest speakers come in. Students also are able to go on general business tours. The exploration portion of the model really opens up eyes and minds of students to what jobs and careers are out there. Tier two focuses on exposure. JAG-K students have found a career that they are highly interested in and ready to really dig in and learn about a specific career and career pathway. Students match up with employers to interact on tours, webinars, online or in-person training. Students really dive into the learning about specific careers, and that moves them on to tier three, and that's experience. JAG-K students are focused on careers, gaining personalized hands-on experience. Students are going to career-focused training. They're doing job shadows, internships, and apprenticeships. They're volunteering with businesses that they may be interested in working for. They're getting informal mentorship from employers and business leaders in their community. The ultimate goal for employer engagement, of course, is that JAG-K students secure within their desired pathway certificates, certifications, job-specific credentials, continuing education opportunities, and employment in a specific career pathway. Johnny Matlock, a career specialist in Hayes, Kansas, has created a video to showcase employer engagement and what it has meant for his students and then the employers involved with his program. So please enjoy.
Hi, my name is Devontae Walker. 2020 graduate. I'm going to be walking next weekend to Great Bend, Barton County for wrestling and a music scholarship. I've been in the JAG-K program for 2 years and I feel like it's benefited me in interviews and resumes to help me get a job, and I feel like the guest speakers that came in helped me decide on which career I want to pursue, and I'm interested into business and marketing and stuff like that in real estate, so I feel like it really helps.
Some of the good qualities that I think employees should have is being able to be a team worker, to be able to work well with others, dependable, hardworking.
My name is Kirsten. I'm the general manager here at North Hayes McDonald's. We look for employees that encompass soft skills and leadership skills and like to be a part of a team, and Devontae came to us with those skills, and here he gets to put those in play and flex that muscle on each shift that he works.
My name is Gail Keel, and I'm an owner-operator with McDonald's in Hayes, Russell, Waukene, Kansas. We recently retired, but before that date of retirement, I had the privilege of working with the students and with Mr. Matlock in the JAG-K program. And I want to emphasize before we go any further how impressed I was with the program, how impressed I was with the kids, and how much of an honor I thought it was to be asked to participate. First and foremost, it's really important to help kids in whatever form and whatever program and in any way that you possibly can, especially if you're a member of the business community. As you work with these kids, you build lifelong relationships with them. The reason that I think it's important is communicating to youth that education is vital to their success in the future. And I feel very strongly that they need to see positive role models who have that belief that education is the cornerstone for their success as they get older. And I think it's important to be involved with programs like JAG-K to show the kids that preparing for the workforce is really important.
Thank you, Joni, and a great video, Joni. I appreciate that. It's always fun to hear about our students. And now it's my pleasure to introduce a special guest. Laura Eberlin is Citizen Project Manager for John Deere's World Headquarters, a position she has held since September 2017. Eberlin manages John Deere's signature youth mentoring programs with a particular emphasis on connecting youth to careers at John Deere. Laura, thank you so much for joining us today. I appreciate you making the long trip to Kansas.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so great to virtually meet all of you on this call, and it's always a privilege to talk about our relationship at John Deere with JAG, which started in Iowa, but has expanded to JAG Kansas, and really talking about our employer engagement model. So thank you.
Where are you at right now? Are you in Illinois?
Yeah, so my work location is our headquarters office in Moline, Illinois. I live on the Iowa side of the river, so the Mississippi breaks us a little bit. So I'm a 20-minute drive to the office in a normal pre-COVID situation, but I'm working from home.
Very good. So, yeah. All right, we're anxious to hear what you have to say.
Thanks. Yeah, and are my slides up? Or am I sharing? Okay, perfect. Perfect. Looks great. So again, thank you for having me. And again, it's always a privilege to talk about John Deere's relationship with JAG and our expansion in our employee engagement model. You unfortunately get to see what I really look like in this quarantine state beyond my headshot there. But if you want to go to the next slide. The John Deere Foundation started our relationship with Iowa JAG in 2005. And so they started as an entity in 2000. So we kind of gave it 5 years to say, what is JAG about? And how does that align to our CSR strategies and focus areas of what we want to support in education and community development? So in that 5-year evolution, when they started and we started supporting them, they were showing amazing metrics and amazing metrics around their secondary graduation rates, reaching this high diverse student population so vital to our communities, and showing and proving out that success, which aligned to our theory of change in our corporate citizenship group. And so we started financially investing in 2005. And throughout this evolution, it's been an expansion of launching more programs in our home communities because we see the vital impact it's had in those measurable outcomes. So we've invested over $3 million since 2005, launching and supporting now 34 IJAG programs. In 2014, we developed a signature mentoring program internally to say, how can we engage our John Deere employees in these schools working with these students? And so that's another really sweet spot to us is working with these schools that are in close proximity to our factory locations to give our employees that outlet to volunteer. So it goes hand in hand when we look at who we grant and how we grant organizations. We really want to have that volunteerism piece because we know that's important to have our employees engaged and who we're financially supporting from a foundation as well. So we have over 70 John Deere mentors who are going into these classrooms around once a month. So not a heavy lift, and we actually have, you know, we see 34 programs and 70 volunteers because we actually have teams of mentors. So we usually have about 2 mentors per program. And so that way, if they're traveling and just have a lot going on with work, they have either a backup or they can go together as a team. And that model's been working really well. And so they'll go simply support the specialist. So whether it's mock interviewing, cover letters, financial acumen, what's a 401k, what is our rules of conduct or business rules of conduct, you know, what does it take to be a John Deere employee? What are we looking for behavioral skills, et cetera. So anything the specialist truly wants support on is what our employees go in to do. And so whether it's social media etiquette, whatever is going on, those mentors go in there about once a month. I actually sit on the IJAG board as well, and I always say there's plenty of room for other employers to go into these schools and do the exact same. So you think about so many days in a month or so many school days in a month, we're only taking up one day of that, and our space is only one day. So I always urge all employers to do the same and build those relationships, and it's really been developmental for our employees to work with these students in developing a lot of core competencies within our own employees. So a lot of value for both partners in this. And then in 2018, we really went full circle into that circle for three category to say, how can we look at these youth as early talent pipeline? We know we have positions that they could pursue. And so how do we target them to give them opportunities they've never necessarily had opportunity for before? And so we started with sponsored certificates. So we have some skilled trade positions within our company that were, we saw a skills gap in. And so that was welding and CNC machining. So in 2018, we started piloting that as well as early talent internships. And I have a couple slides that go into more detail on that. And then looking at how can we expand this? Again, our focus is our home communities. So where does John Deere exist and have a presence? So we again started in 2005 partnering with Iowa, JAG. And then around 2014-15 is when we started partnering with JAG Kansas. So we have a location in Coffeyville and we support the Field Kinley High School program there. And so at a different state of maturity, right, in our employee engagement model. And then we're partnering with JAG Tennessee to say, how can we start supporting programs? And unfortunately, due to COVID and a drop in state funding, we're going to have to push off a program development into next year. And then with Missouri and North Carolina as well. So really just opening those doors and conversations to say, how can we support? Because we know that JAG has amazing measurable outcomes that are so vital to our home communities. And we know the importance to the program. So a little bit more of a deeper dive into the sponsored skilled trade certificates. I always tell employers, you know, it didn't happen overnight for us to get to this. It took 13 years and a lot of conversations with folks to get to this Circle 3 evolution. And so, you know, I always say we don't stop talking about JAG internally. So you can imagine we have a lot of turnover in our company. We had a new CEO get announced. And so we're continually talking to leaders, to stakeholders, to different functional areas, whether it's HR, labor relations, D&I, all these entities to tell them the JAG value and what this program does for our communities. And so through this evolution of discussion, we started talking to our community colleges to say, how can we develop accelerated programs for welding? And how can we then fund John Deere these sponsored certificates where it takes the financial burden away from these youth to pursue these accelerated programs and have a really marketable certificate to get a thriving wage and job when it's over? So we started in 2018 with Blackhawk Community College, a lot of conversations with IJAG, the community college, and to get this going. And we had 11 youth graduate that year in 2018. Mr. Harris is at the top picture in the burnt orange shirt. He is just amazing. I think his smile says it all and the type of person he is, but he has a story that his family fled the south side of Chicago, landed in the Quad Cities, and we presented this opportunity to him, and he says, so I have to kind of back up. He had graduated high school, and he was working at Sam's Club as a courtesy cart carrier. And so because of JAG having that relationship for that 12 months post, they reached out and said, hey, John Deere sponsoring their certificates. Would you have an interest in welding? And he's like, you know, I had welded my freshman or sophomore year of high school, and I really liked it. And I just didn't think to pursue that as a career. And so he entered the 6-week program. And he is now working at our John Deere harvester facility, making $50,000 a year. That's our start out for a welder at John Deere. And so it has more than doubled his earnings. So you can quantify that in an ROI number. And clearly, it's been life-changing and showing them a different career path that he hadn't thought of. And so in 2019, we expanded this beyond Quad Cities and Blackhawk, and we looked at some of our other main operating home communities, Waterloo, Des Moines, Dubuque, Ottumwa, and partnering with their local community colleges to do the same. Not every community college had an accelerated program. Some had a 6-month program. And so it took a little bit of development on the curriculum to say, you know what, we really need it accelerated. This student population can't necessarily afford a 6-month program. They could be taking care of their siblings. They can't take off that working income that they're generating. And so it was all the community colleges were super gracious to open those conversations and get that curriculum set. And then in 2020, we were going to double up and had some really mighty goals to offer $100,000 toward these sponsored certificates for youth. And because of COVID-19, we've had some community colleges close their in-person sessions. So it's taken a little bit of juggling to get those back in resuming those in-person sessions. But we're super optimistic and know it just might be delayed a bit to get these youth who are wanting to pursue these career fields educated and getting that skill set and that certificate. And again, I have my board of directors hat on, and I say in my dream world, every specialist would have equipped a binder in her classroom. And as she's talking to these seniors in high school and trying to figure out what's next, she would have this binder of all these sponsored certificates that employers are sponsoring that they could pursue and apply for. And so for us, it aligns to our business, of course. And so it's welding and CNC machining, but it could be a dental hygienist. It could be a utility man or women repair person. And so there's a million different paths, right? And so that would be my dream, that other employers do the same and we keep giving these youth choice of what to do beyond post-secondary. And this is the evolution to our early talent internships. And so again, it took a lot of conversations with different stakeholders within our company to say, how can we look at these IJAG youth and give them these opportunities for early talent internships? Our internships are paid pretty generously internships, and the intent of them is that they come to us every summer throughout their college journey, and that they in turn, once they graduate, have a full-time John Deere salary position when they're done. So it's a pretty robust program that has a lot of benefit. And so these are two examples. So we piloted this again in 2018 and had two IJAG early talent interns come to us right after their senior year of high school. So obviously they didn't have a ton of work history. You know, maybe they worked at, a fast food chain, a sub shop, whatever. But it was trying to connect to youth that have aspirations for a 4-year college journey. And ideally going into a STEM-related path. So at the time, we were looking for somebody that wanted to go into finance or engineering and go down a STEM-related path, because that's the career development programs that we mostly onboard for. In 2019, we had two additional come to us. And in 2020, we reduced that to just the two returning because of COVID-19 and business conditions. So Ariana and Kayla are in the pictures. They are returning. So they're going in. So they're on their second internship assignment with us this summer, and they're going into their sophomore year of college. We did reduce our internships down to only an 8-week, and it's a virtual experience. And we just try to remove all the barriers from them. So when they onboard with us, we give them a gift card for clothing allowance. We make sure they don't have transportation issues. We offer them mentorship throughout their journey, making sure that everything's going well, they're adapting to our culture, they're not overwhelmed with their job assignment, you name it. We're just continually having open dialogue to make sure that they're set up for success throughout this journey. And so this is kind of a spotlight, right, on one of them. And I always say, only JAG knows the true story, right, of each of these individuals. And every youth has their own story. And so I think nothing tells the Circle 3 story better than understanding their journey and that story. And so this is Ariana Gabriel. She grew up in Rock Island, Illinois. She grew up homeless during her toddler years. She lived in 6 different houses, being raised with a single mom because her dad had been incarcerated for drugs for 13 years. Her dad got out of prison, and he was actually shot and murdered 9 months after his release date. That was when she was in high school, a super vulnerable time for her, and going through a lot of emotions. She actually had worked with math homework with her dad and had loved math, and she just kind of went down a downward spiral, not caring about school, as you can imagine, going through all these emotions after her dad's passing. So talking about the JAG advantage, is her specialist. It actually knew her at a younger age because he was also her basketball coach. And so he knew everything that was going on with Ariana, and he reached out to her and said, Ariana, you really need to get into IJAG. I really recommend it. So she did. She signed up for IJAG. She went to IJAG with a GPA of 1.6. And Mr. Sharp, her specialist, said, okay, let's create a roadmap and how we're going to get your GPA up. Some days were super hard, and she had, 100 pages of reading to do. She had to take 6 AP classes to even have the ability to get her GPA up. And so again, some days were just super hard. And Mr. Sharp, her specialist, said, Ariana, we'll get through it together. You read these 50 pages and I'll read these 50 pages and we'll share our learnings when we're done, and let's do it together. And she has actually referred to him as her second dad. And so when you think about this JAG advantage, right, and you put it in perspective on a youth story, an Ariana story, there is absolutely nothing that can compare that is life-changing to change the trajectory of these youth and get them on a prosperous career path as the JAG advantage. And so we went to her and went into the classroom and recruited her in March for an internship. She graduated high school in May. So she started that summer of 19 with us, and now she's returning this summer in 2020 with us, and she'll be starting her sophomore year at Georgia State University. And if we have time, I'll play a quick video that I think encompasses her story really well. We'll see if you can hyperlink that. Yeah, perfect. Maybe. I don't think the audio is going to work.
We're not hearing anything, Patrick.
I don't know if you can crank the audio on yours and hold your earbuds to it or anything.
We're not hearing anything either. So I'm sorry, I don't think that's going to work. We could send that out as a link.
Absolutely. No problem. We didn't hear the audio. We can totally send that out after. And it's a nice story encompassing the relationship between JAG, these youth, and why these youth are so vital to our communities. So that's all I had on employer engagement. Like I said, it's been a journey, right? We start with the financial investment of getting these programs where it's needed in our schools, to getting our mentors engaged in the classroom and building those relationships. And because we had the boots on the ground and our 70 volunteers in the classroom and had the relationship, it was fairly easy to get to circle three and say, okay, we have sponsored certificates or early talent internships. We want to get in front of these kids. And so it's easy to make those connections because we already have boots on the ground in the classroom building and developing those relationships. So thank you for the opportunity to chat today.
Oh, that's great information, Laura. And I know that's very helpful for us as we develop these things here in Kansas. And we've started, as you said, we've already started doing some things, but there's always room for more. So I want to open it up. I wanted to give us all a little 5-minute break, but I think what I'll do is encourage everybody to just take a break when you need to, because I think there may be some questions for Laura or for any of our speakers. Does anyone have any type of question for Laura about, has this sparked any ideas for you and your own company? Do you have some thoughts about some possibilities that you could see happening within your own organization? Well, if there's no questions, then we will take a quick break. We're coming right back at 11 o'clock. We'll start with the panel discussion at 11, and I'm really excited about that. So take a short break, come back right at 11, and we'll get started with that. Thank you all. Thank you to all of our speakers. That was wonderful. Thank you.
Musician.
Okay, it is a little after 11, so we will get started with the roundtable discussion. But before we do that, I would like to recognize two of our really great partnerships and the companies that are involved in those partnerships. AT&T and AT&T Kansas has not only helped at the national level, but they've been tremendous partners with JAG-K. They were working with us well before I came, and over the last 6 years, I know they've given over $200,000, I think it's closer to $220,000 to JAG-K to help with our mission and our students. And we really appreciate them. We have a plaque that we would present to Molly Coker Boyle. Unfortunately, she couldn't be with us today. She is a member of our JAG-K Board of Directors. We really appreciate her, and she would have liked to have been here, but couldn't. The other company I would like to recognize was just represented. And I don't know if Laura is still with us, but John Deere has partnered with us since 2014. I believe they've given us approximately $214,000 over that period of time in support of Field Kindley High School in Coffeyville, and then also just other activities with JAG-K. We're looking forward to expanding that partnership. I don't know if you can see this. Dan Webster may also be on with John Deere Coffeyville Works. They've just been great partners in the Coffeyville community. This is a very small token of our appreciation for your continued partnership. We appreciate you. I don't know, Laura and Dan, if you are
Oye,
still on.
¿Conoces a alguien que gustaría presentar hoy? ¿Cómo se llama?
Por ejemplo, I don't think
sorry.
That's Laura.
Comunicarse con
We make sure that everyone's muted. We had some trouble with the meeting earlier, and so Sarah, unmuted okay. everybody. But everything needs to mute.
Okay, well, thank you, AT&T Kansas and John Deere, John Deere Coffeeville Works. We appreciate you and look forward.
Oh my gosh. Jack?
Yes.
You were muted that last part. So what did you say at the very end?
I said, Kim, if you can hear me, you get a raise. And unfortunately, that didn't happen. So I just thanked AT&T and AT&T Kansas and John Deere and John Deere Coffeyville Works again for their partnership. And we look forward to working with them in the future to help our JAG-K students and hopefully expand the service in Kansas. And then I said, back over to you, Kim.
Let's see if Alan is there.
Okay, Alan Cobb, are you here with us? I think.
I am, I was a little late. Can you hear me? I'm getting an error message about my speaker.
I can hear you. Can everybody else hear Alan?
If start breaking up, if someone can maybe send me a text or chat, we're all learning how Zoom works and what to do and not to do, but one thing I've learned, if your audio starts breaking up, if you shut your video off sometimes because of, I don't know, computer memory or something. So I could hear everybody the whole time and getting this error message. Well, I appreciate being included. I'm pleased and proud to serve on the JAG-K board. I've known Chuck also a long time. What a wonderful program. Just sometimes we wonder all the volunteer boards we might serve on, what's actually making a difference, and the data is overwhelming. I've had some firsthand experience of JAG students at Highland Park in Topeka, which is probably one of the probably lowest income high schools in the state, and what dedication the staff has at Highland Park, and was impressed with the attitudes of the students about how to improve themselves and prepare for their future. I'm the president and CEO of the Community Chamber. I thought it was just a teeny bit of data. We do an annual CEO poll every year. So it's not just our members, but it's CEOs of businesses of all types, basically with a mix of Kansas industries on sizes. And for the first time last year, so it's every December, so this is still relatively current data, even with COVID, for the first time ever, and we've been doing it 15 years, the quality of the workforce was the second highest important issue, most important issue for Kansas businesses. Taxes is always number one, but it really took a big leap up in 2019, that workforce was an issue. And the satisfaction of the workforce just 10 years ago was 75% satisfactory. This last December had dropped all the way to 54. Unsatisfactory was in the 20s, and now it's 42%. That's with the available workforce. And then we asked the question, why not rate the workforce higher? It was open-ended, but the consistency of the answers was interesting. The number one issue was willing to work. 28% was lack of education. And the rest were, I've been there with a lot of do not know. I think all of these things that the Kansas business community has concerns with, JAG-K addresses directly. So we asked, what was the greatest concern with the Kansas workforce? Far and away, the biggest issue was soft skills, 56%. Only 28% had technical skills. Technical skills are something probably maybe a little easier to teach than some of the soft skills and the things that we've already heard, the great things that JAG-K is doing. And we did break up all the data. If anybody wants a copy of the CEO poll, I will send it to them, to you, because it breaks up by media markets, by the industry, by year. But there's relative consistency across the state and across the size of businesses of the data that I'm mentioning. So what JAG-K is doing directly addresses the concerns of Kansas employers of all kinds. So it's great to be a part of it. So I'm pleased to moderate a panel. We have three workforce HR experts that are part of this panel. I've got some questions that we all came up with that I believe are going to be some questions as the conversation rolls on in the chat room. I'm going to give for each of the panelists, I'm going to do a fairly brief intro, and if you want to add to that, or maybe some background, some more context of what you do. So I'll do this one at a time in alphabetical order. So we'll go Morgan, Sarah, and then Michelle. So I'll start with Megan Kubral, I believe is how you pronounce it. She's at the Mahaney Group, which is a commercial construction company in Wichita, and also that they do some manufacturing. She's a Wichita State graduate, and she currently serves on the Wichita Sherm board. So I'm going to make the bio intros fairly short, but if you want to add anything, Morgan, please do, and then we'll go through the other two panelists to get to the Q&A. So Morgan, the floor is yours.
I don't have too much to add. I just get the privilege of working with the people at Mahaney every day, and each day presents a new situation, so that's my role.
Well, good. You'll be able to expand more when we get to the questions. Sarah Gebert from Koch Industries, she's a KU graduate. I always like pointing out the Kansas graduates and all three-year Kansas University graduates. She is the program manager for talent development at Koch. She helps establish and lead talent development programs and initiatives for finance and accounting professionals within the organization. So KU graduate with a degree in accounting. Sarah, what else would you like people to know about you?
Yeah, thanks so much for having me today. I'm glad to join, and been with Coke for over 6 years now, which is crazy to think. I still think that I'm in college, but I'm definitely not. So excited to kind of share some thoughts and kind of what Coke is doing from a talent development standpoint.
Great. Michelle Gifford, she is the Director of Human Resources at Textron Aviation. She supports the business operations supply chain organization, while also leading Textron Aviation's talent acquisition and workforce development team. She is a Fort Hays State graduate, and I will add one thing on her bio is she is a Black Six Sigma Green and Black Belt certified. Now, when I saw Black Belt, is that part of Six Sigma, or is that Black Belt self-defense? And then, so the floor is yours.
It's all part of Six Sigma. Thank you. I don't have anything that I think we should get to the panel. There's some great questions.
Okay, well, the very first one, and I don't know which of you came up with this one, but the question we should all ask ourselves, but be interested in you, and we can take it in any order of the panelists who wants to jump in, but looking back, what do you wish you could tell your younger self? Well, Michelle, you're unmuted, so we'll start with you.
Okay, well, you know, looking back, I would tell my younger self to network and explore. So I think a lot of the youth programs that are available now that weren't available when I was in high school, which is a few years ago now, that are out there now, I would just say network and go explore some careers. I think it's one thing to, you know, hear your parents or someone talk about their job, but to really go and see that, whether it's an internship or shadowing, I know that was brought up earlier this morning as well. I think that's really important to just go spend a day in the life and see what it really looks like in application.
Sarah, you're next person I see on the screen.
Yeah, I think mine would be pretty similar, and just, you know, not saying no to different opportunities. When I, you know, was in high school, I was very kind of focused on checking the boxes and kind of, you know, I was going to be involved in these organizations and that kind of thing, and then on to college, kind of the same thing, and then straight into the workforce. And, you know, looking back, I wish I would have taken a little bit more time in high school to take some classes that, you know, probably maybe were not of that much of interest to me, but I think could have made me a more well-rounded and it opened my eyes to other opportunities. Same with in college. You know, I got a degree in accounting, but I wish I would have taken more classes in economics and communications and that kind of thing. So really just trying to get a better breadth of knowledge, I think, for sure, and just not saying no to different opportunities.
Great. Morgan.
I think the biggest thing is just being patient with trying to figure out what you want to do. Life is unhappy, so just really figure out what makes you happy and do it, because, you know, if you enjoy the job that you go to, then it doesn't feel like work. So that's what I would say.
Great. Now we'll get into more specifics about what you all do as you look for the qualities of talent that you're hiring. What qualities do you look for in a young employee? I would add, is that different than maybe someone in a few more years into their career? And what qualities do you see as deficiency among many of the applicants or the folks that you're interviewing or interacting with? Well, go ahead, Michelle.
I didn't know if you wanted to go in the same order or how you wanted to do this. So, you know, I think qualities we look for is really someone who's willing to listen and learn, but also not afraid to tell us when they see something or question the way we do things. So it's very easy in our day-to-day to do things the same way, because that's how we've always done it. And I like the energy and the new eyes that you bring into our business when we get those opportunities. I think one thing they're lacking, I would like to see more reliance on face-to-face communication and less on electronic communication. I think you can resolve a lot of things faster if you're willing to have that face-to-face discussion. So that would be my input.
Morgan, what is your experience?
I think something that we look for is a level of motivation. But at the same time, I think that's a little bit of a deficiency as well. I think you could tie motivation also into just kind of what Michelle said, of just the willingness to learn. I hire a lot of people that don't necessarily need to have a big background in construction or a lot of job experience, but you can really tell if someone's motivated to actually put in the work and just have that initiative.
Sarah.
Yeah, so I think for us, I mean, I know, you know, we focus a lot on humility and, you know, kind of if we can tell if we think they're going to be kind of that lifelong learner and always seeking to understand something new and, you know, try different things. And I think from a deficiency standpoint, one of the things that we try to develop and would love to see more of is the critical thinking aspect. I think a lot of times people come in and they, you know, they're probably really good at a subject matter, but it's, you know, putting them in a different environment and having them think, you know, through a problem and try to come up with some creative solutions and trying to connect the dots when you don't necessarily have all of the information. So I think critical thinking is something that I know from a new hire standpoint, we focus on a lot and would love to see more applicants come in with kind of that skill set.
That's something we actually may add to our CEO poll next year, is delving into what are the soft skills that, you know, over half, that's the biggest issue for them, but what are some of those specific things like critical thinking. So now, once you've hired somebody, we'll start back with you, Sarah, since you were just there. Once someone has been hired, what are some of the challenges that you have with those younger employees? And I think each of you do some kind of internship or students, whether they're in high school or college, and I guess address both those, just the actual full-time FTEs and then maybe the internships or students, of some of those challenges you have.
Yeah, so I think, I know for us out at Coke, I think, you know, kind of like I said, critical thinking is definitely one that is definitely a challenge for us. And then, you know, also communication skills, which was mentioned earlier, and not, I think we are so focused on, you know, sending an email or pinging somebody or, you know, that kind of thing, but really kind of being okay with picking up the phone or in today's day and age, you know, Zoom calling somebody so you can actually have that face-to-face, or hopefully once we're all back in the office, you know, going and actually talking to people. That's something that we really kind of stress, and we see kind of both ends of the spectrum. We have those that, you know, are not afraid to send an email to the CEO or the president that we kind of have to, you know, pull back a little bit and be like, oh, maybe let's check our audience a little bit. But then also the ones that they'll sit at their desk for an entire day over a problem just because they're afraid to kind of raise their hand and say, I need help, or, you know, I don't understand. So definitely the communication and knowing when to take a step back and saying, okay, I'm not getting this and I need to pull in other people into the conversation.
Michelle. So again, the question was the students that you hire, but also your younger employees once they're on the payroll, some of the challenges.
Yeah, I think the challenge we have with the younger students, and especially in our high school internship program, and I'll talk about that in a moment, is transportation. And so even though we're headquartered in Wichita metropolitan area, because of our location, there's not bus service to one of our manufacturing facilities, and so transportation really becomes a barrier that we have to work to overcome. So, you know, we talk about those soft skills and being on time and all of those things, and sometimes there's things out of their control because they're relying on someone else to come to work. So, and on the high school internship program, so we partner here with our local Workforce Alliance of South Central Kansas, and this summer, we were actually headed to have almost 100 high school interns on site for 6 weeks. It is a paid internship. We've done this. This would have been our fourth year in that program. We started with 5 because, I'll be honest, we weren't sure what we were going to do with high school students in a manufacturing facility. So we started with 5 and we put them all in human resources because we thought we could control their destiny a little bit there, not knowing what to do. The next year, we expanded that to 20. Then to 50, and we were headed again to 100 this summer pre-COVID. So that's been a great experience for the students, but also for our employees and leaders to understand the value that 16 to 19 year olds can bring into the workforce. So that's a little bit about what we've been doing on high school internships. We also have a very rich college internship program where we have typically between 300 and 400 college interns come for 8 to 10 weeks throughout the summer. That's paid as well. This summer, obviously, with COVID, that was reduced. We have about 125 students on site with us this summer, and we shortened it to a 6-week program. But those are some things we do from an internship experience perspective.
Morgan.
I think the biggest challenge, if you think about the field workers, is the attendance aspect, or just being late and not prompt. I think that's a big challenge that we have. On the internship side, I just started doing internships last year, and so far we've had 3 come through. Some have gone on to a full-time position with us in the HR department. I think the common trend I'm noticing so far is it's probably one of the first office experiences they've had, and once they kind of get comfortable in their role and they have several things to do, I think there's a lack of understanding how to prioritize different things, and kind of what Sarah said as well, not knowing when to ask, like, hey, I have 6 things I need to do, could you help me figure out what number 1 and 2 is? So that's a common thing I've noticed. So I would just encourage any student to ask.
Got a couple questions, and I was going to ask this, Sarah, when you mentioned critical thinking skills, because it may sound intuitive, just being able to analyze and ask questions, but I'm sure that Lord and Michelle, you also deal with and want to look for folks with critical thinking skills at whatever level that you're hiring, but didn't know how do you evaluate whether someone has those critical thinking skills? We'll start with Sarah.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's a great question, something that I think we're probably still working on to find a good answer for that. You know, it's really for us being able to, you know, I can speak personally, you know, coming from an accounting background, you know, like, yeah, I can book debits and credits, or, you know, I can prepare a balance sheet for you, but can I really get up in front of somebody and tell the story of what those numbers are actually saying? And so I think for us, it's taking that deeper step and being able to explain something and, you know, this is why I think this, as opposed to, you know, I was just told to do this, so I did it. But, you know, really focusing on the why and the how, you know, so, you know, I'm proposing that we make this decision and this is how we're going to get there. And this is why I think, you know, we should take that direction. So.
Michelle and Morgan, anything to add to how you look at that part of the soft skill? Equation?
No, I don't have anything to add.
I think a helpful thing that I've done recently is to help with those critical thinking skills is just when they come and ask you a question, an intern, for example, I really don't give them the answer. I say, well, what do you think we should do? And that has been a really good tactic, just because they're like, huh, well, I didn't think you were going to ask me that. Let me think about it. And odds are they can figure it out and find the answer themselves, but they have to be given that opportunity to say, oh, like, you know, what do you think? And I think that's really helped.
I'm asking questions about the interview process and when you're having interactions. How important are those first impressions? And are there some particular red flags that when you interview folks that you're going to have to send them on their way? Or are there red flags that are simply fatal, that they're just not going to make it to the next step?
I think the interview process is really important, but also taking into consideration that these people are really nervous and so they're not feeling natural. You have to kind of take that into account. Of course, being late to an interview is a little bit of a red flag. If someone didn't appropriately fill out an application all the way through, seems like a pretty simple task that could be completed following instructions. I'm sorry, I'm having a little trouble hearing you a little bit, Alan. Did you ask about things that we look for that impress us in an interview also?
Oh, yeah, we could, how important are those first impressions?
Yeah, so I think just having even a small level of interest in the organization or understanding of the organization, being able to ask a couple of questions about maybe the company history, I think that's really impressive. And then also just having some sort of confidence to them. They might not know what they want to do long-term for their career, but just being able to confidently be themselves, that's a really good first impression, in my opinion.
Michelle?
Yeah, I would agree with that. So eye contact is important. Again, you know, we get so used to our screens where maybe we don't have to look someone in the eye to have a conversation, but that definitely shows a level of self-confidence, which I think is important. I think the other thing is having a couple of questions for the interviewer. So, you know, at the end, we typically close with what questions do you have for us, or what question did you prepare for that we didn't ask you? So having thought through that a little bit, and again, we take into account the nervousness, maybe their first job interview, et cetera, but first impressions do matter.
Sarah.
Yeah, I don't know that I necessarily have anything to add. I think they touched on everything, but I'm, you know, very similar that first impressions, they do matter. And, you know, a lot of it is just showing up and being on time. We totally get that, you know, kids are nervous and it's probably potentially their first interview, and we're happy to kind of go along with that. We've all had our first interview, but, you know, a lot of it is just, you know, the handshake, being on time and, you know, kind of being willing to share.
Sarah, we'll stick with you. Have you had a mentor that's made a major impact in your life, whether professional or even personal?
Yeah, so I had one. He actually led the intern program out at Coke when I was an intern, and you know, somebody that I kind of stayed in touch with. He's actually now my boss, but you know, he encouraged me really early on in my career when I was kind of struggling with some different things to really explore what my personal strengths were. So, you know, while I was an accountant and I could do the technical side of it, I wasn't really finding the fulfillment in it that I wanted to. And so, you know, he really encouraged me to take a step back and understand, like, what do I need in a job or in a career to feel fulfilled, and what are the natural strengths that I have, and really lean into those strengths and try to find a career that better suits those, as opposed to focusing on the weaknesses and, you know, or the things that I'm not that strong in and trying to make them strengths, really just kind of focusing in on the things that I'm already good at and making those even better. So, you know, he's been a great, great resource for me, and I'm lucky enough now to report to him directly. So I get a lot of FaceTime with him, but definitely something that I've kind of taken with me throughout all of the different steps in my career.
Michelle.
Yeah, so we've had some more formal, I would say, matched mentoring programs, but I've found the most value in informal mentors. So those folks that, you know, I found a connection with, or, you know, see that, you know, maybe they're different than me, and that's even more important to have them from a mentoring perspective, someone that you can build that relationship and gain trust with, to just be able to ask those questions, whether personal or professional, how did you deal with this situation? So definitely mentoring and people that are willing to advocate for you are important.
Morgan.
Yeah, I feel like I have so many mentors. I feel like when I first started in the HR realm, I really just reached out to a lot of people and just wanted to soak up as much as I could. But if I could say, the most impactful mentor to me has been someone who's completely different than me. So different age, different race, different job, different industry. I think it's really important to connect with someone that's different than you, and someone that challenges you. And that's what one of my mentors does.
We'll start with Michelle this time. I'm not keeping track of what order we're going in, but what is the path that led you to your career 5 years ago? Would you have thought you were where you are today? What do you enjoy most about what you're doing and working at Textron?
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. So interestingly enough, I think it's fascinating that there's another panelist here that, you know, has an accounting degree, but found their passion in human resources. So I've been with Textron Aviation just a little over 20 years and started in actual public accounting before transitioning here to corporate accounting and finance, and just had different opportunities along the way. I referenced networking earlier. I would say networking is really what's helped me get to where I am today. So we talk about first impressions, but I think it's all impressions. So you never know when an interaction or a presentation or a cross-functional project may lead to an opportunity in the future. So that's really what's allowed me to get to where I am today in human resources. I've only been in HR about 6 years. So I would certainly say 10 years ago, I wouldn't have found myself or in an HR position. So definitely think I found my passion here, being able to influence people and help them find success. So whatever that looks like for them individually. So sometimes that's, you know, exploring different career opportunities. Sometimes that's, you know, training or certification, or really just connecting them or getting them on the right path, whatever that looks like throughout their employee experience. So I get the benefit in my role today of seeing all levels of employees and being able to work with, you know, the high school student all the way, you know, up through our senior leaders. And so that's what I enjoy most about my career here at Textron Aviation today.
Morgan.
Yeah, so my path is a little different. My first office job, I would say, was I was hired to scan papers all day. And so I just made it my goal to scan those papers as fast as I could so they would be forced to give me something else to do. And that's what I did. So I dipped my toe a little bit in the HR world, accounting, customer service, and that's where I really found that I really liked HR. And that was at a former company. So then in January of 2014, because of the HR experience I had, I was able to come on board doing payroll and HR. And since then, it's been 6.5 years, and I have the opportunity to work with the executive team here now at Mahaney. And so that's been a really big, proud moment for me, just thinking about just in 2012 where I was full-time student, full-time employee. I just enjoy the rapid pace of which I was able to keep improving, and I really enjoy it.
Sarah.
Yeah, so when I started out at Coke, I was in an accounting role and did that for 4 years. And during that time, I helped with the college recruiting program at Coke up on KU's campus. And kind of what started is just really a fun way to get back on campus during the week, which, you know, as a new hire, I was like, this is awesome. You know, it really kind of became much more of a passion of mine, and really not necessarily recruiting the kids to come to Coke, even though that was definitely a benefit, but really helping them identify where they wanted to get in their career. So kind of as I, you know, continued to explore that, the opportunity came up to join our talent development team. And it was a relatively new team at the time. So it was just my boss, because Coke was kind of exploring it and seeing if something like this would stick from a accounting and finance standpoint. So joined that team and have really been lucky to be able to, you know, help provide the training that, you know, a lot of our new hires need to kind of get to where they want to go. But at the same time, you know, we put on trainings for more of our senior level things and, you know, how to better connect with the new hires and, you know, how to develop the vision and that kind of thing. So it's kind of been a roundabout way. 5 years ago, this definitely would have been my dream job. So I'm glad that I've had the opportunity and doing something that I very much enjoy and enjoy going to work every day. So.
Well, speaking with you, Sarah, if you explain more what Coke does, and this will be the same question for Michelle and Morgan about ongoing training, personal development, whether technical, analytical, et cetera, how you handle that at Coke.
Yeah, so, you know, when I started and, you know, being in the accounting background, you know, I very much went into it kind of with kind of what the public accounting firms put out there. You know, you're going to do this for 2 years, then you're going to do this for 2 years. And I, you know, Coke didn't really have that mental model. It's kind of like you make your own career path. And, you know, there's a lot of on the job training and that kind of stuff, but there wasn't any sort of structured talent development at that time. And so, you know, a couple years went by, and that's when the group that I'm currently on kind of got formed, because Coke noticed that gap that while we have, you know, excellent resources on how to connect with Coke's culture and, you know, that kind of thing, there wasn't any sort of programming put into place on connecting them to Coke's, you know, mental models and economic thinking and kind of those things. So that's kind of where our group kind of was born. And so now, you know, we touch all of the different disciplines at Coke and, you know, have some new hire onboarding training that we do. And, you know, we try really hard to get people exposure to different areas too, because we're all working together, right? Like, you're not just working in your silos, even all the different Coke companies, you're not just working within your company. There's a lot of knowledge sharing that needs to go on. So now we have, you know, structured programs. A lot of them used to be in person. Now we are exploring the virtual training world, like I'm sure everybody else is. So, you know, it's a lot more structured now. It's still, you know, do you want to participate? So we're not, you don't really necessarily force it on anybody. We kind of nudge the supervisors to help the employees get there. And, but I mean, one of Coke's big things is self-actualization. So you have to want to learn and you have to want to develop. So we're not going to force anybody to, but I'm really kind of playing on that to help in people's development.
Great. What do you have at Mahaney? Continuing development.
Yeah, so I think something that might seem a little odd when you talk about construction is we do leadership training. And I think it's odd for them too, because they're like, what do I need leadership for? I'm out here working on a building. Well, actually leadership can be anywhere. And so that's one thing that we've really focused in on. Another thing I'm working on right now is a human-centered design platform of just understanding from their perspective what they want. Because why am I going to be someone who creates a training program and creates this guideline without them? And it's just a phrase I heard, nothing about me without me. And so I've really just stuck to that. And I want them to have some just say on what we do. And I'm getting ready to start that process on some additional training opportunities. And I'm really excited about that.
Sounds fascinating. Michelle.
Yeah, so, you know, like many companies, we do have a very generous tuition reimbursement program. And so obviously all of our employees can take advantage of that, whether that's a technical certificate all the way up through, you know, a bachelor's degree and or master's degree. So that's, you know, a pretty traditional approach, but we do have that. We also have done some work with on-the-job training. So, you know, again, especially when you go through periods of hiring, you may have people who, you know, have not necessarily riveted sheet metal before. So we do have blueprint reading and sheet metal and some of those trainings here on site in the classroom and hands on. And then beyond that on the shop floor, some on the job training. Within our, I would say, more professional space, we do have, you know, whether it's conflict management or other professional development or leadership training as well. So, you know, we're part of the larger Textron enterprise, and so we do get the opportunity to do things across business units. So, you know, whether that's our sister company, Bell, in Fort Worth, or specialized vehicles in Georgia, we do get to do some cross training with those business units as well to, again, continue to build that network across the enterprise. So we also encourage, again, that career exploration. So, you know, whether it's between functions within the same company or, you know, because of, you know, maybe where your family is or a spouse transfers, we do have opportunities globally as well within our own space, but across the Textron enterprise. So those are other things we do from just a more career development and training perspective.
We're getting to the last couple of questions or so. And so if anybody has some questions, certainly put it in chat. What's the, and we'll stick with you, Michelle, what makes an ideal employee? I know you've got thousands and thousands of them at Textron, but what are some of the characteristics of the ideal employee?
Yeah, I think it's just, you know, that work ethic. And, you know, we talked about attendance earlier, coming to work. So show up and be present, right? So I think it's that. And then understanding what it is you want to do and what your passion is. And if you can find that passion and we can help you find that passion, then I think, you know, we all move forward together more effectively.
Morgan.
Yeah, I agree. Like I said earlier, just motivation, work ethic, like Michelle said, showing up, having a good attitude, and just willingness to learn and put in the work. I think a lot of times people forget you have to do step 1, 2, and 3 before you can jump to step 20. And I know it's exciting and you want to get there, but just understand you got to put in the initial work first, and then you're going to get to where you want to be.
Sarah.
Yeah, I second all of that. And I think, you know, my biggest one is just showing up every day ready to learn. You know, I think we all probably take something away, something new every day, and not being afraid to learn, you know, not being afraid of the negative learnings too, right? I think we learn a lot from our failures. And so, you know, kind of always being willing to take those and just pulling out what we can do differently next time.
Okay, I think this might be our last question, but we've got a really good one that I think, I can't remember who actually, I mean, Michelle, it might've been you, it might've been Morgan or Sarah, about the interview, the questions the interviewees make. What are some of the questions that you wish you would hear that you don't? Michelle, we'll start with you. Whoop.
Oh, she might have froze.
Yeah, I said we're still learning Zoom. I think our next round of computers are going to have a lot more memory and RAM.
I think a little bit of research about the competition versus, you know, it's just a job.
You're back.
Did you lose me? Okay, sorry. I think it's around asking questions about the company. So show in a little bit of research.
Morgan?
Another thing that is usually impressive to hear is what's my opportunity here? I'm being hired for this position, but is there an opportunity to grow? And if so, what comes with that opportunity? What responsibility or what benefits? I think just knowing from the get-go of what they're looking for, I think that's a great question for someone to ask.
Sarah.
Yeah, I think, you know, if they've done a little research, I know from a Coke standpoint, our culture is very important to us. So asking us, you know, like, how do you see the culture play out in your job or, you know, the company that you're in? And, you know, just kind of diving more into those deeper details.
Kim, I think about to turn it back over to you. Are we about the right time here? I want to be respectful of everybody's time. And we've gone through an awful lot of questions, a lot of great responses from the panelists.
Yeah, I wanted to introduce our Vice President of Programming, Beverly Mortimer. She was going to be watching the chat. Was there anything earlier that you saw, Bev?
Hi, and thank you all for taking time to be with us today. Of course, we preferred in person to see you and hear from you and interact with you, but we're glad you went to that extra trouble to carve out some time in your day where you could spend with our staff, because I think the information you're giving them is very valuable. They're hearing from you. I mean, one of our goals is to make sure our kids are work ready or ready to go to school, and hearing directly from you is very beneficial. So with that, there were a couple questions that I will give you. Michelle, I think it was you mentioned a shift in the summer internships, and I know we have some specialists who experienced the same thing. They had some work opportunities lined up for their kids. So somebody asked, what was that shift, or how did you handle doing internships in this new virtual world we're experiencing?
Yeah, so unfortunately, we canceled our high school internship program for this summer, but we're looking to see, you know, maybe what the school year looks like and what those opportunities might be through the school year for those high school students, because we do think that's really, really important. On the college side, we did end up paring down our population for interns this summer. One of the things we did was we really focused on rising seniors. So those students are going to graduate either in December or May that would be looking for full-time employment next year. In addition to that, we also looked at where they were physically located. So obviously many universities closed down and students finished online. So back to being part of the larger Textron enterprise, if we had students who, you know, their home was in Texas, for example, maybe we were able to place them at our sister company Bell versus moving them back into Kansas for the summer. So again, trying to be respectful of all the COVID challenges, We opted not to do virtual internships. We did go ahead and move on with in-person internships. So we probably didn't adjust in the same way as some others did.
Thank you. Yeah. And I can add a little bit to that. So from a Koch standpoint, so we typically have, our internship program is focused on the college age, and we have about 500 interns nationwide with our different companies. And so we went the virtual route, and it has certainly been a learning process. Our word for the summer has been pivot. We just continue to pivot. And so it's been really great, because I think in some ways the interns have gotten exposure and experience to things that they wouldn't have if they were in the office. Certainly it was not as ideal as we wanted it to be, but just trying to roll with it. And a lot of our companies went to more of just a programming route. So, you know, the interns spent a fair amount of time with our team on just kind of connecting to the fundamentals of Koch, and, you know, what they can experience in accounting and finance and that kind of thing. And then some of our other companies did, bring their interns on site. So it's been a mixture, but certainly a learning experience for all of us, as well as the interns. So
thank you. There are a lot of ways that all of the employers across the state, and especially those of you participating with us today, can make the investment in our kids, which is simple as spending time with them. A lot of our kids could greatly benefit from having positive role models and seeing people in those work positions and interacting with you. So any lessons that you can start with in our classroom, anything that you can come in to do. Now, one of those big things, I'm leading up to a question. One of those big things is we work with teenagers. And if you've ever owned any of your own, sometimes they don't always agree and you don't always agree on what they should wear to an interview or to the workplace, or what's in style versus what's appropriate for work. Because that's one of the things we do. A lot of our people do units, those PBL units on dress for success, and they take kids out and they do shopping exercises to pick those appropriate outfits. So if you have any, I think we want your thoughts on that professional dress versus being able to express your individualism. And that includes then some of the issues today of, and somebody said, we like it when people challenge, you know, or ask questions about why we do things, because we, on our side, we work with kids of different diverse backgrounds, including religious beliefs, ethnicity. And so that idea of being able to dress for your ethnicity, your religion, wear your hair, that is who you are. Have you guys had to deal with that? What is your advice to us in preparing kids for after school when those are some of the issues we're trying to address while they're in high school?
Yeah, I'll speak to that. So I think dress for the job you want, and obviously hold a level of professionalism. But for me, for example, if kids showed up for an internship here and had nice jeans on, tennis shoes, maybe a polo shirt, I would see no problem with that. If they came in slacks, no problem with that either. But I have had people show up to an interview in pajamas, and obviously that's a big extreme difference, but it's a real thing. I've seen people at job fairs walking around like that. And so I would just say, be yourself and dress for the job you want.
Yeah, I would echo that. That's great advice that Morgan had there. I think in addition to that, right, so you talked about, you know, them being able to be themselves. That's important, because if they are not coming to work, and if they're not able to bring their whole self to work and feel like that they have to hide behind whatever their uniqueness is, I think that that's going to cause more challenges than it's worth. And look, honestly, as leaders in the business, we own that as well. We own accepting that. But students have to be able to come to work and be comfortable with who they are, and we have to be comfortable with that as well. So I agree on the dress piece of that, but back to your question around you know, expressing their individuality and who they are. It's important that they be able to bring their whole self to work.
Okay, and on the hair question, because I don't want to keep skipping over it, really just what I said also, just being yourself, there are some certain hairstyles that would be a safety hazard in our field division. If that was an issue, we would address it there, but be you. You're the only one that can be you. So I say welcome whatever. I hope that answers the question.
I think it does, and honestly, we've had a number of these conversations, and even some of our employees have talked about professional versus being yourself, and that they've had to change or get a haircut to be more like they thought the job wanted them versus who they were. So I appreciate you addressing the question on hair. You know, honestly, we've also seen various lawsuits in schools where kids are forced to change their hair based on a school dress code policy. So in trying to prepare kids for what what they face and how they are prepared for jobs, any of this advice from you, the employers, is very helpful to us.
Okay, were there any other questions, or are we good to wrap up? I think from the chat, if you had a question that was in the chat, I think we got to all those. So I just want to let you know that all the participants, our business leaders, you should be receiving a follow-up survey that will give us some feedback that will help us connect your local career specialist with you so that you can begin developing some of these partnerships. I'll be working at the state level with Bev and Chuck to and the rest of the team to do some more work and really get this ball rolling with employer engagement. And if you don't receive the survey, please reach out to me. You all received an email from me earlier. You should have my email, kim.fertig@jagkansas.org. But please fill that out. And also, Alan and Laura, Alan, if you could send me your poll that you were referencing, and Laura, your video, then I will email those out to you as well as attachments along with our competencies, our JAG-K competencies that our students learn while they're in our program. So thank you again for joining us. A special thank you to all our panelists and our guest speakers. We hope next time it'll be in person, but for now, stay healthy out there and have a great rest of your day.